Hello, everybody, and welcome to the SoxProspects.com podcast. It's the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from top to bottom, from Fort Myers to Worcester, across the Pike to Fenway, actually across the country to Los Angeles and Anaheim, across the border in Toronto, up the Allegheny River. Wherever it is that the Red Sox are searching to find new players to bring into the organization in exchange for their prospects. It was a big trade deadline, folks, and we've got a lot to talk about. My name's Chris Hatfield. His name's Ian Kundle. It's the trade deadline, Ian. It's a busy time of year for the site. It's also the draft signing deadline coming up, but that's going to be pretty uneventful because the Red Sox got everybody under contract. But really, the big news here, trade deadline, man. Trader Craig is in the house, it seems.
Yeah.
Like.
Craig Dabrowski. No, I'm just kidding.
I think we're gonna have to talk top level in a bit about like.
Yeah, no, I think it is there needs to be a more nuanced discussion because I feel like a lot of people are gonna make that comparison, and I think there are differences in the way they've approached it. But we'll get to that in a little bit. I thought it was a very exciting trade deadline. Yeah. I felt like you'd go away for an hour and you'd look up and at least one deal was done, and there might not have been the biggest name traded, but the volume of trades was just very fun, and a lot of prospects changed hands. And I think the most exciting thing to watch is going to be you know, which of these kind of, because not a single, according to Baseball America, not a single top 100 prospect was traded, though I have a feeling Augustin Ramirez will be in their top 100
soon.
At the next month, probably.
Well, maybe, but the thing is, you've got draftees coming in, right?
That's true. But he's probably should be a top 100 prospect. But anyway, you know, which of these lower level guys is going to pop? Because you know there's going to be like a Yordan Alvarez, O'Neill Cruz type.
Sure. Well,
in
maybe
one of these deals, at least maybe. One. No, there maybe. Will be. I mean, probably. But it'll just be interesting to see, you know, who found that gem. And maybe it was one of the guys the Red Sox gave up. You never
maybe.
Know.
Maybe we'll see. There's not, how many players were traded from the system?
10.
Wild. 10 of them.
I wonder when the last time the Red Sox gave up 10 players at the deadline was.
At the deadline? It's been a minute.
I feel like maybe Dabrowski would do his in the offseason.
Yeah,
so
Dabrowski
wonder.
Didn't necessarily make a bunch of trade deadline deals. He made the big splash trades he made were Kimbrel in the offseason. Thornburg was in the offseason. Sale was definitely in the offseason. I think the big ones were all in the offseason. In season, he just tweaked. Of course, he also, you know, built the roster more in the offseason, so they didn't need a ton. But yeah, I can't remember the last time they made this many trade deadline moves, or at least traded away this many guys. I mean, the trade deadline that came to mind, and we'll talk a little bit about the Rule 5 ramifications from this trade deadline, but like there was a trade deadline where the Red Sox moved Chi-Shin Chang, Stephen Fife, Tim Fedorovich, and like one other guy who were all Rule 5 eligible that offseason, and it was clearly just unloading guys. But I don't think they moved 10 guys that offseason. We'll have to look into that for the next episode. Anyway, before we go any further, if you enjoy the show, a few ways you can support us. First, spread the word. Tell a friend, tell a relative, tell your new neighbor who just had to change work locations because his office traded him across the country to another office. You can rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Spotify, wherever it is that you listen. And it's your final chance to support the Sox Prospects donation drive. Our goal was to raise $10,000 this year. I think I could safely say we're past it at this point, but we want to hit that stretch goal. Let's get it to 11, man. Let's go full Spinal Tap here and have ours go to 11. Help us reach our goal. Got some travel planned. Of course, it also goes to helping with our IT costs, hardware, software, internet, hosting, etc. For a one-time donation, you can head to SoxProspects.com/donate, and you can also support us on Patreon.com/SoxProspects. And finally, of course, send your emails to podcast@SoxProspects.com because we want to talk about what you all want to hear about. Ian, let's get into it. Trade deadline. The Red Sox made 4 deals of note, and then there's a bunch of other things that happened around them. All right, so should we just go maybe chronologically? Might be the simplest way to go about it. So
I think that makes sense.
Well, on the intro,
do you just want to knock out the signing deadline thing first.
I kind of do and I kind of don't. Okay, fine. We could do the
Let's just do it because this is not a long conversation. And I think it's just good
there,
to remind.
There isn't a conversation is the reason I was going to push it. I mean, the Red Sox signed all their draft picks, which is the first time.
Yeah.
I don't want to downplay it. Everyone is saying, like, great job. What a great draft. They signed all their draft picks. It's not an achievement. It's what they planned to do, which is not always what they planned to do. It's not like it's a good job you got everyone signed thing.
Right. Going in, you have a plan of how many picks you're going to sign. Like
right.
Last year, they clearly were not going to sign three picks based on the math. And you
they were backups.
By the math. It's not like.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not like the, you know, the, what was it? The Senquez Golson year when you could sign as many guys as you could give money to who wanted it. So
yep.
Like this year, it was when I think we talked about it on the draft review that it didn't seem like there were really any hard signs after the 10th round other than Brady Tigert. Mm-hmm. And once Kaysen signed and the math was clear for the top 10 rounds, it was pretty obvious that there was enough money to get him also.
Yeah.
Even with Peyton Toley getting probably more than we expected. So
but then Montgomery got under slot. So, right. Like,
yeah, there was just there wasn't a lot of like uncertainty. They were always going to sign everyone or not everyone. They were always going to sign the top 10 rounds. If a guy gets drafted in the top 10th round, he's almost certainly signing.
If he doesn't, something went sideways, right? Like
exactly. Usually medicals or a guy changes his number or something like that. And then after the 10th round, since they didn't take any high school kids, they didn't take any guys with strong college commitments.
Fair.
It was pretty clear to me that they were going to sign everyone there. So
that was
kind of it.
Yeah. I mean, we don't know the numbers yet. We don't know the numbers yet on four of the guys. Devin Futrell, the 10th rounder, Steven Brooks, the 11th rounder, Brady Tigert, the 12th rounder, and Shea Sprigg, the 13th rounder. They're all college pitchers. We do know the numbers on everyone else, and the three biggest signings, unsurprisingly, were Braden Montgomery, who got $5 million flat. By the way, the Craig Breslow regime is apparently all about nice round numbers.
Yeah, it's actually kind of fun.
It's very aesthetically pleasing when you look
it's
at the
It's good for us page. Who use an abacus.
Braden Montgomery signed for $5 million, which is about $484,000 under slot. Peyton Toley in the second round signed for $2 million, which is about $150,000 over slot. From there, you know, you can go to the draft history page on the website at SoxProspects.com. The third highest bonus went to eighth rounder Conrad Kaysen, who got $1.25 million in the eighth round. That is a solid million plus over slot. But really, the Red Sox used the money they saved on Montgomery for half of that. And they just saved like little bits in the third through seventh rounds. There's no more. They really don't do the like $10,000 bonus thing anymore, which is not true of every team. Like the Angels gave three guys like a grand.
A bunch of teams did that. I saw a bunch of like $2,500, you know, $5,000, $10,000 bonuses. I just think it's a situational thing now. Like,
sure.
If they don't need to, they don't want to, because they probably see more value in taking, like, you know, someone like Hudson White and giving them $185,000 versus taking a 10K guy and losing out on someone like White.
And it's funny because the last bonus the Red Sox gave to a player who was drafted after the third round that was as large as Kaysen's bonus. Do you know who it is?
Yeah, Ty Buttrey.
Ty Buttrey. But if you look at that year, because that was back in what, like
2013?
Was it that long ago? Maybe.
No.
12. No, it was 2012.
It was 12, yeah.
Yeah. If you look at it, all the picks around him, the guy's got like 10 grand. Like, or even 1 grand. I think that might have even been the JT Watkins year where he got a grand because he was going to go.
And Kyle Krause got 1,000.
Yeah, Kyle Krause. Like, and it was guys that got to Portland, but it was like no one that sniffed.
It's basically after the fifth rounds, 5 through 10, it was 25K, 125. 125,000, then 1,000, 10,000, 5,000, 1,000. So five out of their last six picks in the top 10 rounds were 25,000 or below.
Yeah. Mike Ogliero was one, right?
Yep. He threw strikes. Nathan Minnick, Miller make the majors. Remember that?
Mike Miller made the majors. That's true. But it was like they basically punted on five picks to sign Ty Buttrey. That's not what they did this year to sign Kaysen. Yeah.
So,
yeah, so I get it. It's a fair, but like, yeah, I mean, the like thing congratulating or saying what a great job they did. It's like, it's just the, that was the strategy. When you don't sign guys on day three, it's because they were backup plans in case something goes sideways with the guy on day one or two.
And I think actually that though this draft kind of plays into
it did
what they
100%.
Did at the deadline, because I think it's too in the sense
that's
that,
not what I meant, but yeah,
I don't necessarily mean as much in the domestic reserve list as this front office is bringing in their guys now, or guys that kind of fit the traits that they want. And I think especially it's, they probably view it as, you know, with, I guess it does kind of play with the domestic reserve list now that I'm furthering the thought in my head. But,
yeah, I was going to say, I don't know where you're going with this, but that's the only way I can see the draft factoring in. Yeah.
But like, this is, there's opportunities now. They can go out, they can get, you know, if you trade 10 guys here, we can backfill that now with guys that we're specifically targeting. Like they have the option, like they have, you know, between the draft and international now, you know, the spot, if you trade a guy, you're opening spot just for someone else to bring into the development system now. Whereas in the past, it wasn't like a an either or situation.
Zero sum game.
Yeah.
Is, I think, whereas
now, whereas now you actually do have to look at it like, okay, you know, I have this roster spot for this guy on the DRL, but if we trade him, it and you know, we do a 3-for-1 or a 4-for-1, it opens up three spots for us to add in who. And that's where the draft and the international market is going to be coming in. And I think just going forward, you kind of have to look at it like that. Same thing with the Rule 5 draft. It's like, we trade Nick York and Matthew Lugo. Okay, does this allow us to protect now Alan Castro, let's
and
say,
Paulino.
Or someone?
Yeah.
Hey, well, no, I know. I was just using them too.
Right. Those were the two more certain guys. Yeah, I feel.
But does that? But does that allow you to protect this player that you might not have before? Like,
Zephyr,
that's
John,
how you kind of have to look at the math now. So
yeah. Yeah. We'll talk generally about the draft in a second. I mean, I just, with the draft picks thing, as far as guys getting into games this year, it does seem unlikely that any of the pitchers are going to throw in games. I could see maybe like Zach Erhard getting some games in Salem, or Will Turner. Hudson White's interesting because I think they're going to just need catchers in Fort Myers to catch all the pitchers.
Yeah. Well, especially with the Tricky League games going on.
Exactly.
Assume we don't know that for a fact.
Well, if that's what happens, I could see that not happening. Actually, we'll see.
They're already in the FCL games, having to run like 7-inning games or just like rolling innings, basically.
Yeah,
so
and the FCL Red Sox from the last week of the season, promoted a bunch of guys. They had a thin roster, and then they've already promoted, two or three, like two guys today. They promoted Dennis Ruggiero and the guy from Oakland, Eduardo Rivera, the 6'7" guy, to Salem today, to backfill some innings there, when they traded Vargas and Batista and Portes. So, I mean, they're probably going to get even more arms at this point. So we'll see. We'll see what happens. We'll see who goes up. Like I said, maybe a couple of the college bats, but that's probably going to be about it.
Yeah. I mean, mate, who knows?
We'll see. I don't know.
Plans can always change, but yeah, maybe one of the pitchers shows up and is further ahead. But yeah, I think it's the bats are a much, much better certainty to get some game time.
Yep, exactly. Anything else on draft picks? I mean, it's the normal stuff. You know, we'll talk about where they might slot in next year, you know, at a later date. Rankings wise, you'll see where they go in a week.
I was just going to say that, Holy getting 2 million shows how much the Red Sox really valued him. So,
yeah. And I don't know if you got a chance to listen to the Jim Callis interview yet, Ian, but he was saying Jim's actually down on Tolley, although, as he admitted on the show, and one of our readers on the forum recalled from last year, he was down on Christian Campbell last year. So he's like, what do I know? But he was saying, you know, if you like Tolley, then he's like, look, there are teams that really like Tolley. I do not particularly like him, but if you really like him, here's what you see. Red Sox clearly really liked him.
Yeah, it's a unique archetype. It's a specific archetype that is not for everyone, but we'll see.
Yep. Yep. All right. Well, let's get into the trade deadline, and that's what people are looking for here. Really, the action started, I guess, on the 26th, of July with a really small deal in the Red Sox reacquiring James Paxton from the Los Angeles Dodgers in exchange for Moises Bolivar. Paxton had been designated for assignment after his start against the Red Sox. The Red Sox needed an arm. It just made too much sense, Ian, to me, to not do, especially when the price tag was that low. I mean, that's the long and short of it, right?
I couldn't agree more. And I also just would like to point out, if you ever wonder why, if pitcher wins mean anything, James Paxton was 8-2 and was designated for assignment.
Good point.
But yeah, it was Paxton obviously enjoyed his time here. I think he, you know, the Dodgers was a great situation, but when he became available and the cost was so minimal with the Red Sox needing pitching, that was a no-brainer. And yeah, it's just a perfect match for them, and hopefully they can kind of get him turned around, because it's weird. He's like, if you look at his numbers, it's too many walks and the strikeouts have just disappeared. That's kind of the biggest thing. Like last year with Boston, 101 strikeouts in 96 innings. This year with the Dodgers, he had 64 in 89 innings. Like, I'm curious what happened there.
And, well, a lot of it's the fastball hasn't been nearly as good this year, right? I mean, that's been kind of the main story, as far as I've been aware.
I was just going to bring up some stuff to look at for him. But, I mean, I like getting him in the lab, see what you can fix, and
deserve better than he got tonight. Actually, went 4 1/3 so in his debut.
The got defense screwed was over by the
defense.
Thing.
Yeah,
it is interesting though. I'm looking at it, like, his extension is pretty different. Last year was 6'8". This year it's 6'5". That's not like a
3 inches. Is, that, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting because it would have been good for the Red Sox to bring in a better starting pitcher. And maybe it's possible they did. We'll talk about that in a minute, Ian. But, you know, Paxton wasn't the splash. I think the reason a lot of people were down on the first two moves the Red Sox made is when it keeps getting built up, the team is going to get a right-handed bat and they're looking for a starting pitcher and they're looking for a late inning relief arm. When the first move or two is not like the right-handed bat or a big relief, or, you know, people are like, what is this? This is the move. And it's like, dude, there's 3 or 4 more days. Chill. Like, there's more time. They're going to make more moves.
Yeah.
I guess we're just conditioned. You know, this isn't like the Mariners where your GM is addicted to trading, but you know, it was nothing big. I mean, you know, Moises Bolivar was hitting in the middle of the order for the DSL Blue squad. He was hitting 270. With a 364 on base, 423 slugging, 3 home runs. Interesting bat. They gave him a $25,000 bonus. Yeah, neat. I mean,
he wasn't in the group that we heard was kind of their top guys down there. And
yeah, which may have been by omission, frankly, with the way I
never know
about it. You know, it could have just been he didn't come to mind, but he was also not top prospects down there either.
Well, but also, I mean, he's relegated to corner infield and the DSL is generally not the best, so who knows. I mean, that's a lottery ticket. Clearly the Dodgers saw something they liked, or it also could just be kind of like, remember the Inmer Lobo trade? Like, it could also just be, hey, you have a list of like not very good guys, just pick one. So
yeah, it could be that. I mean, it could be Inmer Lobo, it could be Gregory Santos for all we know, like hitter Gregory Santos, right? Like,
yeah, but I feel like we knew Gregory Santos was good though,
not before he got traded. I don't think
he was I thought he was like decently known from down there, but I don't know.
I don't know if it got to us, put it that way. I know we heard after the fact, like, yeah, he's one of the guys down there, but anyway, I don't think he was ever ranked by us. So anyway, whatever, agree to disagree. So Bolivar. Okay. I'm fine paying Bolivar to get James Paxton is the moral of the story, I think. Right. I mean, that's really what it comes down
to.
Yeah,
I mean, it was whatever.
Fine bit of business, right? All right, next day, we've got a bunch of draft signings. Talked about that in the last episode. The Red Sox acquired Danny Jansen from the Toronto Blue Jays, and this is when we start seeing a little more of what the MO is going to be. And with the Red Sox sending Edinson Paulino, Cutter Coffey, and Gilberto Batista to Toronto. Paulino, of course, AA infielder, ranked 15th in the system at the time, or now still, I guess. Cutter Coffey, high A Greenville infielder ranked 28th in the system. Gilberto Batista had been promoted to Salem and not pitched yet. So I guess technically was traded out of Salem, had been ranked once previously for 1 month at number 60, but had kind of more hung around the fringes of the top 60 in that kind of range just outside of it. It's this theme, Ian, of there's no one there where I'm pounding my fist on the table and saying, why, oh, why did you trade this guy? On the other hand, it seems a little steep for what Danny Jansen has been this year. Maybe one player too many. Maybe, you know, one or two of the players could have been a little worse, a little lower on the rankings. I don't know. Again, it's
disagree. I don't really care. I just don't think they gave up anyone that is going to hurt them long term.
I mean, I don't disagree. As I said on the last episode, it's if you told me none of these guys even made the majors, I'd believe you. If you told me that maybe it winds up being a little bit steep of a price for a 2 month rental in Jansen, I would maybe believe that too.
I mean, but who cares? Like, I mean, I don't know. When it comes to, like, I'm kind of the mind at the deadline that as long as if you can keep your top guys and you're giving up, you know, guys that are flawed in a way, like you're not giving up lottery tickets in this essence, in this deal, which we'll get to lottery tickets that I'm more concerned about dealing with later. But like Gilberto Batista's whatever. I mean, he's, you know,
yeah, whatever.
90s fastball, 81 to 86, like change up. He basically throws sliders only. He's slider heavy already. He's a developmental relief prospect that just doesn't really do anything for me.
Right.
And if he's the piece you're worried about, I just wouldn't go there. But like Cutter Coffee, I don't think Cutter Coffee can hit, honestly. He's had one good month in his entire career. If you take that out, and I did the numbers, if you take out his June of this year from this season, his numbers are so. Here's the full thing. In June of this year, he had 92 plate appearances. He hit 300, 391, 638. Rest of season, he's 179 plate appearances, 206, 285, 375.
Like, yeah, I said in the last episode, he probably falls in the rankings this month from 28.
Yeah, I mean, it was a nice
month. Good amount. Yeah.
But he just doesn't do anything that well. He, you know, he has raw power. He's got a good arm, but it's not a shortstop to me, and I don't really think the hit tool is ever going to get to a level where he can hit quality pitching. So I think it's more likely than not that he's probably going to face some significant challenges adjusting to upper minors pitching. So dealing someone like him to me there are a lot of guys in that similar rankings area, like the 25 to 35, 25 to 40 range, that I would be much more hesitant to deal than him, if that makes sense. Cause I don't think he's someone who's going to come back to bite you long term. And maybe I could be wrong. And if he, you know, maybe he makes some adjustments to the swing, because there is talent there. But I don't think the swing will ever get to a level where he's going to make enough contact. And then with Paulinho, if that's the guy you're worried about giving up for a rental who's, you know, a quality big league player like Jansen, or if that's the price, that's fine with me. Like, again, Paulinho has one significant wart that will keep him from ever being most likely ever being an everyday player, and that's he can't hit lefties at all. And so he's a platoon bat at best, who is, you know, he's a solid defender. He's got some positional versatility, but, you know, if that's a utility guy, probably. I look back, and I know it's one that gets referenced a lot in Red Sox history, but you traded Santiago Espinal, who turned into an all-star, for Steve Pierce, and do you think twice about it? No.
No.
And so, like, even if the Red Sox don't obviously go on a run like they did back then, if Danny Jansen is a contributor down the stretch and they make the playoffs, you're not going to think twice about dealing in some Paulinho, who, even if he turns into a utility guy for him. So I don't think it's that much. I think that
I think our disconnect comes from the evaluation of Jansen is not the I think we're on this exact same page on the package. I think the thing with Jansen is he hasn't really hit this year. And he's a guy you're bringing in, expecting him. And granted, the bar is so low replacing Reese McGuire.
Yeah, but Reese McGuire was terrible. Like, he's arguably the worst catcher in baseball. So
that's what I mean. That's what I mean. It's a very low bar to be better than him. It's just that, you know, what is the upgrade is what the question's going to be. And it's very possible.
I think it's a massive upgrade, because Reese McGuire's not a good defender and he can't hit. So, like, I think with Danny Jansen has a really, really good approach. He also has had injuries this year, and I do wonder how much of that has impacted him at the plate, because I believe he had a thumb injury, I want to say.
He has injuries every year is the problem, too. He does get hurt a fair amount, but he also catches, so catchers get hurt. But yeah, he was hitting well before the injury, and since he's come back, he just hasn't.
Yeah,
really so well. Like, so maybe they're thinking playing him less, he'll be able to heal a little more or something.
Oh, sorry, it was a wrist injury was the issue.
Even worse.
So I just, to me, like, I think the other thing is Dan Jansen's an excellent defensive catcher. Like, he's 98th percentile in blocks above average this year, and that's the area that Connor Wong is arguably the weakest in. So I think they're a really good platoon partnership, and in a weird, not platoon, but like duo.
Duo,
and,
yeah.
And also Danny Jansen's whole thing is pull power. Like, that's perfect for Fenway Park.
Sure.
So
sure.
I don't really care about, I don't really like, when I think about Danny Jansen, I don't really care what he's done so far production wise. I'm looking at projecting for the future and for the rest of the season and what he can do in Fenway. And I think that the upgrade he provides in Reese McGuire is substantial enough that that package doesn't really bother me at all.
That's fair. That's fair. I have zero qualms with that evaluation. They just need Jansen to produce. Along with that move, Alex Spies was designated for assignment from the Worcester bullpen. Just can't throw strikes. Was worth the flyer, but they need the spots now. Moving on the 28th, the Red Sox did not make any trades.
Before we move on, though, I think it's interesting that how they're going to play both him and Wong together.
I guess that's fair because
I think this rolls into why they didn't make another move for a right-handed bat. And it seems like they're going to try Wong at second base against lefties, which is kind of interesting to me. He's looked, I guess, okay there defensively so far this year. And if you're doing it, once a week, not the end of the world, given how good Wong's bat has been. But I think it's just a creative way to get, because you kind of have to keep Wong in the lineup at this point. It's kind of a creative way to get two righties in the lineup without having to pay the price for the middle infielders. And if you look, like guys like Rengifo and all the names that were mentioned there, none of them got dealt. So
yeah, it was such a seller's market that, like, did you want to give off
a few teams like the Rockies? What are you doing?
Yeah. Ugh. Angels too made some curious moves. It's like, did you want them to give up a lot for Rengifo?
No, I don't think he's good at all.
Yeah,
he doesn't hit the ball hard, which is
Rengifo better than like Romy Gonzalez? Like, seriously,
I'm not sure. And the other thing is, and I don't necessarily agree with this, but if they have Vaughn Grissom coming back, and they're probably going to give him another chance at second base because.
It might not be this year because apparently he's getting optioned when his rehab runs up.
I think it said he might get optioned.
Might get optioned. But,
like, we'll see what happens. But, like, they have Jamie Westbrook on the roster right now, and this will be discussion in the future, but I would try to find a way to keep Dom Smith around personally.
I think that's Tristan Casas started a rehab assignment tonight. Sounds like they want to get him back in about a week. Maybe.
I don't love that. I'd give him more time personally.
Yeah.
But I just think that when you look at with the other right-handed options, like, I like Danny Jansen's fit with his approach and swing in this park better than a lot of the other options they could have gone out and got and weren't willing to, pay the price for the top guys, understandably, in my
opinion. It almost makes Connor Wong the acquisition.
Exactly. Because now you can play Jansen and Wong against lefties.
It's an interesting thought. That's how you replace Westbrook on the active roster is essentially with Wong.
It's like Connor Wong, Romy Gonzalez, basically. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is fair. So we'll see how that works. That's a great point. Thanks for adding that. On the 28th, the Red Sox claimed Johan Ramirez off waivers from the Dodgers. He finally got activated tonight. Welcome to Boston, Johan Ramirez. Probably one of the worst games the Red Sox have played this year. The Red Sox designated Reese McGuire and Chase Anderson for assignment when Paxton reported and when Jansen reported on the 28th. Cooper Criswell pushed to the bullpen. Ian, I saw a lot of people wanting to keep Criswell in the rotation. I had no problem pushing Criswell to the bullpen for Paxton. Did you even think twice about that?
No, I also think he'll start games the rest of the year. Let's be honest. Sure. very much doubt this starting five is going to stay healthy the rest of the season.
Well, stay healthy, just, and honestly, I could see
they're going to need to skip guys at some point. They're going to need to I think they're going to start needing to go to a six man on occasion to give Houck and Crawford extra rest. Chris Wells is going to get plenty of starts and be a valuable guy. So that doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah, if you look at the upcoming schedule, they played yesterday, tomorrow. They have an off day on Thursday. Then they have six games in a row with an off day on the following Thursday. Then you get a couple of long stretches of games without days off. They go from the 9th through the 21st without an off day, off on the 22nd. Then they play August 23rd through September 4th with no off day. So they've got a couple of longer stretches of games coming up. They do not have any more of these six-game stretches with an off day. So they're going to need to start working in a sixth starter every now and then, I think, in order to kind of give these guys a little bit more rest. So I think that's a great point you make, Ian. Moving on to the 29th, yesterday, the Red Sox.
Well, do you want to talk about Yoan Ramirez at all, or not really?
I mean, I have nothing to add. Do you? If you got something on him, go for it.
Well, no, he checks the boxes of 95th percentile for extension at 7.1 feet, high ground ball rate, limits barrels, limits hard contact. Like it's, you know, sinker sweeper. It's kind of their MO for reclamation projects. So let's see if they can do something. I mean, he struggled tonight, but maybe they can unlock something there.
Maybe. And if not, you move on. Yep. Yesterday, this is the most interesting trade they made for me, Ian, is trading Nick York 1-for-1 to Pittsburgh for Quinn Priester. I like this trade a lot.
Could not agree more.
One scout who I talked to said, look, it's hard to find guys with Priester's upside. You can get guys with Nick York's upside.
Mm-hmm. I'm surprised they didn't have to give up another piece, honestly.
I was surprised at that, and I was surprised the number of people on our forum who didn't like the trade.
That's not just there. People just Twitter was people were up in arms, basically saying they traded their best asset. It's, do you know what's wild to me is I bet Priester has been high, maybe not, because I guess Priester was in top 100 last year. Like just because he's
in the 60s, he wasn't even the top 100. Like my point is legit. Just,
he's had that issue of when you get up to the big leagues and fail, people kind of write you off. Whereas Nick York, if Nick York had, you know, played 60 games in the big leagues and hit 200, people would probably be fine with the trade. But because he hasn't yet, they're like, ooh, shiny toy, forgetting that he was terrible in AA this year. And
he was terrible in AA for 700 at bats or 700 plate appearances.
And he got up to AAA, and I give him credit. Like, he's been great. He's been very impressive there. He looks more engaged. He's putting together better at bats. He's hitting the ball hard consistently a lot. Like he's did everything that you were hoping he would do in AA to start this year. And maybe it was just the change of scenery is what he needed. But at the end of the day, I just think with York, there's just upside limited there. Like, it's hit over power. I don't think there's a lot of over the fence power. There's no speed, and defense, he's second base fringy, left field fringy. So in the modern game and the way the Red Sox want to play, he just doesn't fit their team at all, because he doesn't bring the speed and athleticism that, you know, the guys like Hamilton, Rafaela, Duran do. He doesn't bring the impact that guys like Abreu, O'Neill, Devers, just looking at this year's team, do. And he doesn't bring defense. So I just think that a hit tool only guy, you have to really hit. And I'm not sure that he's, you know, the plus hitter you need to be for that to work. I think he's closer to an average hitter than a plus hitter. And so for me, that type of profile, I'd be very open to trading. And just because I just don't think there's that much upside. And for them to be able to get a former first round pick with big time pedigree, you know, I think he's from North Carolina high school kid or Texas high school kid. Good size, you know, throws. He's got some good pitches, really good ground ball rate, does a good job of minimizing contact, throws a ton of strikes, has been excellent in the minors, even AAA in the International League, which, as we've seen with Red Sox pitchers, is not easy to pitch well in that league. And yes, he's struggled in the majors, but I think there's just some traits you can really work with here that Greg Breslow and co. have done a great job of emphasizing specifically. Quinn Priester has great feel for spin, clearly. He, you know, coming up, his breaking ball was seen as at least plus, if not better. It's had, I think, a 46, 47% whiff rate in the majors this year. Granted, it has been hit also, which strikes me as you just got to tighten up your command of it. Maybe they go to a sweeper. Maybe they just, you know, change the breaking ball a little bit, change the slider a little bit. He's clearly got feel for spin that they can work with, and they've shown the ability to optimize that type of pitch. And so if they can do that with him and eliminate, I think eliminating the four seam or kind of changing up his usage to focus on what he's best at, then I think there's, you know, mid rotation upside here.
Yeah.
And I will take a chance on a, you know, AAA mid potential 3, 4, or 5 starter over a guy who's probably like a second division regular at best, more likely a utility player in York, any day of the week. I just, especially in a system that's devoid of starting pitching in the high minors like the Red Sox are.
I mean, even if you're bullish on York and you think that there's a first division regular in there, it's not like that's the projection right now. Although it was, you know, I did see one evaluation that was super bullish on him that said he's no more or less than a, you know, MLB regular, average regular at second base, which I thought was extremely, extremely bullish. Yeah. Look, I liked York. I like what he'd turn himself into in AAA. And you know what? If they hadn't moved him at the deadline, like if you wanted to yell and scream for him to get a shot in the majors, I don't think he would have been insane.
Well, the problem is he doesn't hit lefties, so he wouldn't have fit with what they need either.
And it's look, can't hit.
No, I was just going to say that he has reverse splits, and I think that might be a thing for him throughout his career because he still struggles with, again, secondary pitches, especially changeups. And what does a lefty throw to a righty? Changeups, breaking balls down. Like, so it kind of fits to me that he's having his struggles with left-handed pitching when the pitches he's seeing the most from them are the ones he has the most struggles with overall.
Mm-hmm. And look, it sounds like Pittsburgh might call him up pretty quickly because they just need
bats badly. Yeah. I saw them play last week, and
yeah,
they're, by the way, Paul Skeens is incredible. Like he is the best pitching performance I've seen in years. And
although he lost with you there,
yeah, I saw his first career loss. No big deal. I'm going to remember that for the rest of my life.
Yeah, but, Jim was giving you crap for that. Actually,
it's my fault probably.
Yeah.
Watching him pitch and then seeing, you know, he's thrown zero after zero up, made one mistake pitch, and then it's like the eighth inning and it's still 1-0. I was like, oh, poor guy. Like, this is really going to happen because their offense is rough. Some of the names they're throwing out there. And now Nick Gonzalez, who had been pretty good for them this year, is out. Mm-hmm. So they don't have, they have an opening at second base. So I wouldn't be surprised at all if York got a shot this year.
Yeah. Yeah. So we'll see. I can't wait to see what happens with him at the majors, and best of luck to him. But I'm excited to get Priester in. We got the question a lot on Twitter, Ian. Priester is no longer prospect eligible. He's at close to 100 innings in MLB. I think he's at like 98 or something. So he's well over the threshold to be ranked. But if we were ranking him, I mean, easy top 10, right? I mean,
I would have him ahead of York. I would have him ahead of York, definitely.
No question, which is basically what we were just saying, right?
Yeah. So I'm looking at it right now. If you're adding him in, and I'm just going to I guess I'll add Montgomery in also because he's obviously going to be in the top 10.
Well, put it this way. Top three, then Montgomery. Campbell, then, you know, that Blaise, the two shortstops, Perales group gets you to...
It's like him, Sandlin, Arias, Cespedes is the last four in the top 10, probably.
That sounds right. Yeah.
So
yeah, that's what I have.
Yeah, I'd probably have him closer to Perales though than Sandlin. It's in that range though. He would be 6 to 10.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I will say, like, the thing with York and the way that he can greatly exceed expectations is if the power comes at the big league level. And that's just the part I'm not convinced about. Because I will give him credit. He's hitting the ball a lot harder this year than he did last year and more consistently. Like the hard
not even this year. In AAA.
Yeah, in AAA. Specifically. The EVs are up, the hard hit rates are up, but it's still like the launch angle optimization isn't there that I'm just not sure he's going to ever tap into raw power because he's not the biggest guy either. He's, you know, 5'11", 6 foot. So if he can get up to, you know, maybe being like a 20-25 home run guy, that's where the thing could change. But I just don't think he has that type of raw power right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but to chalk me up as a fan of that deal personally. And I love the one-for-one, like, prospect.
It's
for
the kind of creative
prospect.
It's
deal.
The creative trade that we talked about a lot in the offseason. I kind of wrote about in that pitcher article, like the ways you can get like high-end interesting pitching is, you know,
this is how you use it.
Yeah, the pitch is the position player for pitcher swaps, like Jazz Chisholm for Zach Gallen, like things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And this is going to be a fascinating one to watch. And I think it was Keith Law who was writing about it, and he summed it up well. It was like, this is a trade that could like fail spectacularly for one team or be beneficial for both, basically. Or yeah, both teams could just be like, whoops. Like it's just a really fun challenge trade.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The other piece of this, Ian, and I want to go to this here because the next trade doesn't really bear on this at all. It seemed very clear that Craig Breslow viewed the kind of high A to triple A infield as an area he could deal from, and in fact should deal from. When you look at York, Paulino, Coffey, Lugo wasn't playing the infield at all at this point, but like, even to the extent you want to throw him in there, kind of, it seemed like that was an area he knew that he had depth and that he could move guys that had value without moving, as you put it, his top guys in you know, Meyer. In Greenville, they didn't trade their best infielder. And by infielder, I mean second, third, short. In Portland, they certainly didn't move their best infielder. They may not have even moved. They didn't move their second best infielder if you count Campbell. Debatable who the third best infielder in that infield was between Jordan and Paulino. I'd say Paulino. Yeah,
they're very different. Like, I don't think you can compare close. Those two, though.
They're very different, but I'm just saying. I'm just saying, like, is it clear that Paulino is better than Jordan?
No, maybe. I mean, they're the same tier.
Right?
They just get to it by different ways.
Right. In AAA, it's not clear that York was their best infielder when you consider, like, Mydroth, right? When you consider...
Yeah.
So it's like that was an area they could deal from, and if they were doing
a bigger move, I do wonder if someone like Mydroth would have been someone you look to deal. Because I kind of have similar concerns that I do with him with York about what is his potential like impact or mm-hmm. upside there. I think that they're doing what we've kind of been talking about, where it's you got to pick your guys. And after that, everyone should be available.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty clear who, like, the big three are the big three. Christian Campbell is in that next tier. We're not going to even talk about Montgomery because he's not played yet. But, like, Campbell's in that next tier. Then it's Cespedes, Arias.
Blaise.
And then after... I'm just talking about infield.
Got it.
Yeah. And then it's, like...
After that, move wherever you need to move.
Yeah, exactly.
No question.
Like, if Mydroth got traded, would you have been surprised? Probably not, right?
No, not at all.
Like, if...
Mikey Romero wouldn't have been surprised.
Exactly. So I think that that's, you know...
Jordan wouldn't have been surprised.
That, you know, you kind of established who your top guys are, and then after that, because everyone has value at a certain point, but there is also, you know, as we've talked about over and over again, guys like Bobby Dalbec, that reaches a point where it becomes diminishing returns. And if you miss that peak opportunity to trade them, they might not have value by the time it comes back around.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that, you know, moving those guys who are both, it serves two purposes. It clears out the Rule 5, any potential logjam for that. But it also is, you're not touching, you know, you still have depth at those positions. As you said, you still have Mydroth. You still have Mikey Romero. You still have guys like that. So
yeah,
I think it made sense.
And I think with you, just to put the button on York, this very easily could have been trading Nick York at the peak of his value. Like maybe his peak value was Greenville.
Probably after Greenville in 21. Was it 21?
21, right? 22 was the year he was hurt. After 21, that was probably the peak of his value. But like, if we're starting from after that, this might be as valuable as he gets.
I would love to ask the Pirates. Obviously, they would never say anything. But if you could ask them, like, you know, Ben Cherington at a press conference, would you have made this trade with Nick York as he was, like, the day he was promoted to AAA? I would love to know that, because I do wonder how much of an impact his, like, six weeks or whatever he had in AAA had, because that was the best he's looked at the plate since that Greenville year. So,
I mean, we got reports, and never mind just how he looked at the plate, but just on the field, not in the field, just on the field, like, it wasn't inspiring, put it that way.
No. I mean, I saw him, like, I sent you some of the videos of his at-bats, like, in Portland beginning of the season. It was bad. So, I mean, I think this is a deal that could work out really well for both sides. You know, hopefully Nick York goes on and has a nice career with the Pirates.
Yeah.
But I think Priester just fits what this organization needs so much better.
100%. And then today the Red Sox made a couple of deals. I think I said four. It's really five trades. The first trade that came in, we heard the one thing the Red Sox hadn't really gotten yet was help for the bullpen. You could say that getting Paxton pushes Chris Well to the bullpen and Chase Anderson out, which is a net positive for the bullpen. But with Chris Martin out and Justin Slayton out, and honestly, Ian, with the two trades they made today, I don't quite know what to think in terms of those two. And even Liam Hendricks, I guess you could throw into the equation as well. When or if they're going to come back. And this strikes me as the team is not relying on them to come back. You know, yesterday the Red Sox optioned Greg Weissert to Worcester, which in part was because the bullpen was gassed and they needed help. They called up Trey Wingenter, who was then today optioned to Worcester and designated for assignment when Johan Ramirez was activated. But, you know, part of it was to get Weissert some work on his slider. I think he'll be back up in August at some point. But the Red Sox went and acquired Lucas Sims from Cincinnati in exchange for Ovis Portes, which I know is the one that you're worried about. And the Red Sox acquired Luis Garcia from the Los Angeles Angels in exchange for a package of Matthew Lugo, Ryan Zephyrjohn, Nico Cavadas, and Jefferson Vargas. I guess let's start with the one that came in this morning of Sims in exchange for Portes. I don't quite feel the same way about it as you do, but I completely get where you're coming from on this one when we've talked about it.
So I think that I really applaud Craig Breslow for going for it in this regard, that he's not waiting around for he could have easily said, oh, we're going to get Chris Martin, Justin Slayton, and hopefully Liam Hendricks in the next month. Like, yeah, we'll be fine. There was a sense of urgency, which was really nice to see. And him be like, we're not going to count on those guys. If they come back, you know, great. We'll have an even better bullpen. But we need help now. And I think that Lucas Sims and Luis Garcia both with some tweaks can both, well, Garcia less so than Sims. Sims needs some tweaking, specifically something I brought. It was funny. I mentioned on Twitter after the trade that I would love to see him further emphasize his cutter. And then Alex Cora in his press conference like an hour later was like, yay, it's a really good sweeper and a really good cutter. And I was like, okay, yeah, that made me feel like I was looking at the right things. Well, no, yeah, it made me feel like I know this organization's pitching development and what they're going to be looking for now.
Sure.
But I think that Portes of the prospects they traded has probably the most upside, just in the sense that we're talking about a 6'4", 19-year-old who's up to 99 with a fastball that is very unique shape in that it has big horizontal movement and good vertical movement. And they just don't have a lot of pitchers like him. They don't grow on trees. You know, you're not getting guys with his type of projection. And I know it's raw and he's probably a reliever, because that's what a scout reminded me of today when I was texting with him about the trade. But I don't know. It's just the type of guy who could pop to me. And I completely understand why they trade him, but I think it shows how he was valued around the game, that he was a one-for-one for Lucas Sims. And Luis Garcia, who I think Lucas Sims, Luis Garcia, you're talking about a similar caliber of player, whereas Luis Garcia they gave the Angels four prospects for him, shows how Portes was valued around the league. That was a one for one versus Garcia was a four for one, basically.
Oh, I mean, look at all the reliever trades that happened. Never mind just that one, right? I mean,
I think Portes has pretty good upside, and it could be even as a reliever. Like, he might just end up being Lucas Sims. And if he does, I mean, I'm sure the Reds would be thrilled with that outcome, because they get 6 years at, you know, cheap.
Sure. But, as opposed to Sims, who's a rental.
Exactly. So I'm slightly worried about that one. I just think that his ceiling, he has more ceiling than any of the other guys they traded at the deadline, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. I think that's not wrong. I think it's, you know, look, he was much better in the FCL than he was in Salem. In the FCL, he was dominant for scoreless outings, 13 innings in which he struck out 16, walked four, allowed five hits. He was dominant down there. That's why they moved him up so quick. In seven outings in Salem and 21 innings, he's walked 15 guys. He's also struck out 25, which shows you the potential that's there, but 17 hits. He has a lot to work on still. It's not like this is some Anderson Espinosa phenom, right?
No. No, he's not. And that's why he was around the 30 spot in the system.
Exactly.
But like, if you told me that he was in 5 years, who is the most likely to be a 60 out of the 10 prospects they traded at the deadline? It's him. And I don't think it's that close. Like, just, well, I think the pathway to
60,
him to get,
it's, we're still talking single digit chances for all these guys.
Oh, yes. No, no, no. I'm saying it's highly unlikely, but you're telling me one of them had to be, you know, one of them becomes, which one would I pick? It would be him, if that makes sense. The odds are very low that any of them will be. Yeah, it's just the projection. Like, he's 6'4", 170 pounds as a 19-year-old, already throwing 99. And fastball shape is there. Command and control is a work in progress. Secondary is a work in progress. But he's flashed enough that, talking to, you know, scouts who have seen him, some like the changeup more, some like the slider more. Both think, like, they think both have potential, though. Like, that's three pitches right there. Yeah, there's just, you know, there's things to like there. And at the same time, it's funny that I, with all that said, there are also scouts who like Juan Valera more than him. So
yeah,
we'll probably have a Valera discussion on the next episode, rankings wise. But I think that that's a fair return. Like, the Reds got what they want, which is a high upside arm. The Red Sox got what they needed, which was a late inning lottery ticket. Trades are going to hurt. And so I think that, you know, it's a steep price, but it's one that you're willing to pay if you're trying to make the playoffs.
Let me ask you this, Ian. Let's say the Red Sox had to give up a Garcia-like package for Sims. So let's say it's, I'm looking here, let's say it's Mydroth. Who's playing the part? Mydroth, Guerrero. Just probably not one for one. Who's playing the part of Nico Cavadas? Mydroth, Guerrero. Maybe not Valera, because I'm trying to think of a Vargas equivalent. Mydroth, Guerrero, Dalton, Rogers, and Freddy Encarnacion or something. Would you rather give up Portes, or would you rather give up Mydroth and maybe not Guerrero? Let's go with like Grant Gambrell or something instead of Guerrero. Would you rather give up the one player or the four? And I'm not trying to make a point. I'm just curious of your thoughts.
Oh, I'd rather Mydroth. I'd probably rather have just in this. I think the reasoning is because of the way the last trade was framed, built around Lugo. Yeah. Mydroth to me is a tier, not a tier, but like a level above the any of the guys they gave up in that other deal.
I guess that's fair. Well, let's say, because the problem is they traded all the guys who are kind of in that Lugo tier, because they traded Paulino.
They traded
and
York and Paulino also, yeah.
Who are the three like guys in the high minors. You know, it's like Alan Castro is maybe the other guy, or you know, Jedickson Paez has maybe hit his way into that group potentially. But yeah, it's tough because they traded all those guys. So it is interesting. But at any rate, the final trade is that trade for Luis Garcia, where the Red Sox gave up Lugo, Zephyr John, Cavadas, Vargas. It's interesting. I think that's just we all, it feels like, have to recalibrate in the era of an extra wild card what rentals cost. Because I think a lot of us in our heads are thinking of Steve Pierce for just Santiago Espinal. Steve Pierce does not get moved for just Santiago Espinal anymore. Right? Like, Steve Pierce gets moved for a package like this of Espinal plus a, you know, top 30-ish AAA reliever plus another, you know, who knows what he is. Maybe he's a 4A, you know, hitter in Cavadas or not, and then you know, probably a bullpen arm flyer from the low minors in Vargas, but a major league arm probably. That's just the going rate now. I mean, am I wrong? Like, that's what it looks like in all the trades that got made.
Well, no, and I think it's the Red Sox, kind of what we talked about earlier. They were like, it's kind of like when you see a trade, it's, you know, you have two, you can pick two routes. You can either pick the quality route or the quantity route. And in the quality route, you get one guy, like the Portes deal. In the quantity route, you get four guys, like in this trade. And the Angels wanted the quantity route, which is something I think we've seen that they like. You know, they're constantly looking to add multiple guys. And the Red Sox were happy to oblige, because again, they have, you know, a bunch of guys eligible for the, or they had some really tough or kind of fringy Rule 5 guys.
Yeah. That's clearly one of the themes.
And
right.
And so that in this trade, you know, Matthew Lugo, no, don't have to make a decision there. Ryan Zafirjan, don't have to make a decision there. Cavadas wasn't getting added either way. So Cavadas wasn't going to get added. So you might as well give him, he now has a chance, you know, maybe with the Angels, he gets up to the big leagues quicker. And then with Jefferson Vargas, he's the other of that trio of FCL arms with upside. But to me, just talking to scouts who've seen him, he's a tier below, largely because he's almost certainly a reliever. He doesn't have a third pitch right now, and he's like 6'1", 215, whereas, you know, Ortiz and Valera are a lot more projectable frames.
Mm-hmm.
So you're basically giving up a lottery ticket reliever and three Rule 5 guys for Luis Garcia. Like, I think that's a nice piece of business there.
Yeah.
And even though it seems like a lot on paper, it's, you know, you're giving up these guys in AAA. It opens up room now. Like, there's nothing blocking promoting all of the big three now at once.
Oh, Worcester almost needs them.
And I think that was part of it, too. It's like, you know, by trading these guys, you don't have to cut those solid high minors organizational guys that you might have to get playing time for the big three. Now you just move them up and they can just slot in right into everyday spots in the lineup. You don't have to cut anyone. Mm-hmm. And I think that was definitely part of the calculus also, was, you know, you don't want to, it would be hard if you were to, you know, make trades and then have to cut, like, you know, half the Worcester roster in order to promote guys. Now you don't have to do that. So I think that the deadline was, in a way, by the trading guys they did, it also played their hand with the promotions that are coming soon.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at the Worcester roster, they've got 11 position players. Two of whom are, I guess it's 12 now because they activated Colosvery. Two of whom are are rehabbers in Costas and Grissom, who they're not going to have at some point in theory. Grissom might get optioned, as we were mentioning, but, like, you know, and plus, like, Gasper and Heinemann are basically catchers. Gasper will also play some first, but, you know, Hickey plays some first, but they don't have a lot of depth there at this point. So they could really use some reinforcements if only we knew where they could find such a player. It's interesting to me, Ian, that Emmanuel Valdez is still around, given that we heard that they were close to moving him for Nate Pearson in Toronto. But again, I think that's just the kind of, like, the players they moved from there were Lugo and York, right? So, you know, it's kind of funny. I saw some people referring to the York deal and saying that the Red Sox chose Vaughn Grissom over Nick York. No, hard disagree on that. I think what happened is Nick York is the player they needed to deal to get Priester. It doesn't mean they chose Grissom. It means that the Pirates wanted York, if anything. You know, are that they, you know, not exclusive to Grissom. It means that the Pirates were interested in acquiring Nick York. And based on what we saw, it seems like the Pirates were, like, pursuing York to some degree, that they liked him. So, I would push back on the idea that the Red Sox chose Grissom over York. I think it's just that's what it took to get the deal done.
They aren't alone. Pirates aren't alone, by the way. There are other teams calling around on York. Like,
yeah.
York definitely has teams that like him. And
yeah,
you can see why. It's just, I just don't think he's a great fit for the Red Sox, as we discussed earlier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. For myself, I was going to have York probably in my top 10, you know, not accounting for trades, going into this ranking season.
I wasn't going to. 10.
Yeah. And I was on an island for that that, but, like, yeah. You know,
but he hasn't moved for me the entire season, which I've just had him at 12 the entire season. Because that's kind of how I view him. But I think, do you want to talk about Lugo and the guys in this deal? Because I think it is interesting.
The key that this one really hammered home, that they knew that they had it's not a log jam, but they had some tough Rule 5 decisions coming up, and they just dealt with it by dealing five if you count Cavadas, but Cavadas was never getting protected. But Nick York, Matthew Lugo, Edinson Paulino, and Ryan Zafirjan were all Rule 5 eligible this offseason. I figured they were probably going to protect two, maybe three of them, depending on what they thought of Zafirjan out of the bullpen. But now Rule 5 gets a lot cleaner.
I do wonder if they've kind of, like, not learned their lesson, but, like, seen what's happened the last couple of years and been like, we probably should be more kind of proactive in this. Look at last year, they lost Shane Drohan, they lost Ryan Fernandez.
And Fernandez is the one that would have been
Ryan Fernandez would be perfect for this team right now, and his stuff fits this front office so well.
Yeah.
I know the injuries, believe me, like that's obviously why they didn't protect him, but he's pitching leverage innings for the Cardinals, who are in the playoff hunt.
Mm-hmm.
And I do wonder if they saw that and were like, why are we letting these guys get there where we basically lose them for nothing when we can trade them at the deadline for an upgrade now?
Yep.
And I think that makes a lot of sense to me. Like if you, and it's kind of what we've been calling for, like have your values, or, you know, have your, whatever you think the future role is going to be of a guy. If you don't think a guy is up to a certain caliber of player, i.e. you're not going to protect him in Rule 5, chop him around and see if there's other teams that are interested that maybe do have him in higher regard. And they did that, and they were able to, you know, get win now upgrades for the team, or in Priester's case, someone who could help in the future for guys that, you know, maybe they weren't going to add to the 40 man. And so I think that that's why, even though it does look like on paper they gave up a lot for Garcia, I'm not that upset about it, because I think that Garcia helps now. I think he's 37. There's no upside, but he's a solid, you know, seventh inning guy.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to throw strikes. He's going to, you know, throw a bunch of sinkers, throw a bunch of sweepers, throw some splitters in there too. He'll get outs for them, and that's what they needed. And Matthew Lugo was a great story this year. I give him a ton of credit. I did not see this resurgence coming. If you saw him at the plate, he looked lost at times last year. He completely revamped his approach. He, you know, improved. He was seeing more pitches. Every approach metric jumped in a level that you just would never project in the high minors to happen like this. Like, this stuff doesn't usually happen, and I give him a ton of credit for that. And he's turned himself into, he's going to play in the majors. Whereas if you asked me last year, I would have said probably not. Mm-hmm. But again, like York, the limitations just aren't a great fit in Boston. He's corner outfield only now. He's not really a runner. I know he has 16 steals this year, but it's more like average speed. So he's not someone you're going to be like, oh, he's a pinch runner. He can't be a defensive replacement for that reason. Mm-hmm. And I do think his swing would work really well at Fenway, because it's pull power. That's his bread and butter, is pull power. But I just, with the defense, the speed, it's just not a great fit in a bench role. So whereas LA, they're kind of rebuilding, they can take a chance. You know, they could play him every day in left field and see what he can do next year.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that he just has more value to them than he did the Red Sox. And so that I think that this is a deal that makes a lot of sense for both parties, moving him out there.
Yeah, then, I just can't see where Lugo plays for this team when I would take all three current outfielders. You've got Anthony coming behind him. You've got Campbell playing some outfield. Like, is another guy that was going to get lost in the shuffle, right? In like you said, in trying to get to Fenway. Sorry, I cut you off. I don't know if you were going to go to the next guy in the deal, in Zephyr John or Cavadas.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say that. And with Zephyr John's the interesting, is almost more interesting to me, because when he's on, he clearly looks like someone you protect, but then he'll go through like a 2-week spurt in four stints where he'll walk six guys and you're like, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's just not that enough consistency. And I think that, you know, if you told me in 3 or 4 years he was up in the majors pitching, you know, leverage for the Angels, I wouldn't be surprised at all. If you told me he was still bouncing up and down between the minors and the majors, kind of like, you know, Caleb Ort is, that wouldn't surprise me either. And Zephyr John's going to continue to keep getting chances because he throws 100 miles an hour and he's got, you know, a good secondary stuff when it's on.
Yeah.
But you just got to find more consistency there. And that's the hard part. You know, I'm not sure there is enough consistency there that they would have protected him.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, being able to extract value there to me makes a lot of sense. And Cavadas is the same way. You know, they weren't going to protect Cavadas.
No.
They went out and got Dom Smith and Garrett Cooper over him, giving him a chance. I don't think there was ever going to be a pathway for him to playing time in Boston. So, now he
fun
has.
Fun player, but
yeah.
You know,
it was the fun best. To watch in AAA. He mashed. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, with LA, I wouldn't be surprised if they do give him a chance now. So, I think it's awesome for him. Like, you know, there reaches a point, and I think we kind of saw this with Ryan Fitzgerald, you don't want guys getting too stagnant in AAA. And there's a difference between guys who are like career or guys and other guys who are in the same organization for multiple years. Career or guys, meaning they jump around from org to org, like Mark Contreras is a great example of that. They kind of know their role. Guys like Ryan Fitzgerald, who, you know, you come up with one org, you perform well in AAA year after year, but you just never get that next call. That can be really tough on them. And I think that giving Cavadas a chance in another organization is also, for the Red Sox sake, is a nice move by them. And, you know, maybe he gets up there with the Angels, where I just think would have been really tough to get up there with the Red Sox. So I think that that's another piece of the trade that makes a lot of sense for both parties. And then obviously with Vargas is the wild card. But I think that overall, yeah, I think it's a pretty solid package for the Angels and perfectly acceptable to give up by the Red Sox.
And just to be clear, the Rule 5 picture for the Red Sox, it's not like it's much, much clearer now, but some of the names that they're going to be deciding on, you know, you look looking down the list, Richard Fitz is still there, Hunter Dobbins, Zach Penrod becomes a minor league free agent if he's not re-signed or placed on the 40-man.
I think he's going to, if he was healthy, I think he might have been in the major leagues already this year.
Penrod?
Yeah, because of that, because like, so left-handed. they have to add him to the 40 by the end of the World Series.
Yep.
If you have to do that with him, and he pitched I think he struck out 7 2 2/3 innings in his first start after missing like a month with a shin injury, I believe it was.
Say this again. You thought what?
No. I was going to say that if he was pitching like he did in that first Triple A outing or. Okay. Since he got back,
I thought you said he threw 7 2/3 in his first game.
No.
Back,
he struck
like,
out
no.
7 2/3.
Got it. Yes. Okay. With you.
Unlike the Big 12 one, I think this one I actually did say correctly.
No, I was saying I didn't hear you.
See, I can admit when I make mistakes.
No, you can't.
Some Twitter narc called me out on it. And
several Twitter narcs called you out on it.
No one likes a rat. That's all I'm
gonna
say.
I had to throw the challenge flag.
I think that like Penrod is a great example of someone that if they need pitching depth either in later in August, is it almost August? Oh wow, it is like in 30 minutes. When this comes out, it will be August. Yeah.
No, there's 31 days in July, brother.
Are you sure?
Yes, positive.
30 days past September, April. You're right. Why is the trade deadline on the 30th?
In the Big Ten, there's only 30 days.
Why is the trade deadline today? It's Why weird. Wasn't it the 31st?
Because the commissioner can set it whenever the hell he wants.
That's stupid.
Yeah. But like, look here, the other names, it's Penrod, it's Fitz, it's Hunter Dobbins.
Dobbins, you would have, before this trade deadline, it would have been like, I don't know if they have room for Dobbins. I think Dobbins is definitely getting protected now. Do you know what I mean?
Probably. Yep.
Like
yep.
That's
and then
the
guys that you're
that
probably,
in.
Guys, Luis Guerrero, interesting question there.
Yeah.
Some other names that they're probably not going to protect: Alan Castro, Yostinson Garcia,
they're
Nathan
just too
Hickey.
Far away. I don't think he gets Blaze Jordan.
Blaze Jordan, your Dynamo Negro is an interesting one. Probably Wyatt Olds probably doesn't get protected, and I could see a team taking a flyer. Senna probably not, but like you could see a team liking him. Christopher Troy probably not anymore, but like Nick Sogard, Jeremy Wu Yelland, is there going to be a team that's interested in bringing him into camp to see what he looks like? They're not going to protect all of these guys. Some of these guys aren't even really realistic ads to protect them, but like.
Well, no, but I think
they're interesting guys to think about.
It simplifies it though. Like it's now to me, it's
significantly
like Dobbins, Fitz. Other than that, is there anyone who's a guarantee?
No.
I mean, I don't even.
Maybe Penrod's probably the next.
Oh, Dobbins, Fitz, Penrod would be the three I think are.
Yeah, and then after that, it's how much do you like Guerrero?
Yeah, but it's like before that, you probably would have had like York and Lugo ahead of them. So just clears things
exactly.
up. And I think another calculus, and I do wonder if this played into it, is basically that Luis Perales is going to be on the 40-man, and you're stuck. So you're basically operating with a 39-man roster.
I'm curious what happens with Wilkelmann and Gonzalez.
So no, but with that, can you afford to carry more guys who aren't like necessarily going to be major league depth?
That's my point with bringing up Wilkelmann and Gonzalez, because he's pitched his way to like,
yeah,
you don't want to DFA him, but like if he comes out of the gate bad next year, like.
But the point I was going to get with though is that, like, could you have afforded with those guys already on there to add like York, Lugo, Zephyr John? Like those are the type of guys
I thought they
sure
weren't going
to
protect Zephyr John, and I would have
I don't think there was room for both York and Lugo. I would have guessed one of the two.
I had both of them. I also had forgotten about Penrod when I was looking at it the other day. So yeah. I actually had it as Fitz, Dobbins, and those two.
Yeah.
And like you just, you know, I don't know how you find room for Guerrero and Zephyrjohn, and you just shrug and admit that one of them's getting picked. And I think that's why when you throw Zephyrjohn into this deal, it's because there was a really good chance he's getting picked in Rule 5, so you might as well get something for him. You know, you're not going to let him hold up a deal to get a guy that can help you down the stretch. So that's part of the calculus. It's not all things equal here. It's we always talk about team control, but we don't talk about like the fact you might lose a guy for basically nothing in 6 months, 5 months, whatever it is. So I think that's a big part of it. Any other trade stuff, Ian? I think we've kind of run a lot of this to ground. I don't know if you want to hit some emails real quick.
No, I just think that I thought it was a very interesting deadline in that it was our first post like DRL trade deadline. And
And
I think Mike ran the numbers. They have a ton of spots open right now, right?
It's at 146 because they released a couple of FCL relievers the other day. The problem is they've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pending DFAs right now. And I mean, McGuire and Anderson aren't coming back, but you've got Wingenter, Spies, and Brandon. I didn't even mention Brandon Walter got designated for assignment. He hasn't pitched all year because of a left rotator cuff issue. Is he ever coming back? Who knows? But like, if those guys clear, are you going to try and keep them around? Because then they get added to the domestic reserve list again. They get added back. So yeah, they're at 146 right now. They've got to add 21 guys. So right now they would be at 167. So they'd be two over. Are there other guys you could throw on the 60-day injured list? So for the Red Sox this week, put Christian Nunez, who was in the FCL but didn't pitch at all this year. You know, there are a couple other guys who are in that same boat, Iverson Polanco and Nicholas De La Cruz in Salem. They could put Austin Ehrlicher and Nicholas Giudice on the 60-day IL as well. So the problem is they've only got two 60-day IL spots open. So those are potential, you know, maybe that's how you make the two spots without really having to cut anybody else. So I think they would like to try and keep as much depth as possible, and it looks like they're going to be able to. So, you know, we were asked on,
and right,
on
and that
Twitter.
Was what that...
Go ahead. I was just going to say, we were asked on Twitter by John Tallender about this.
Yeah, this might be what I was about to talk about. Yeah.
But so go ahead. I think you were.
No, ask a question first.
Well, no, he asked if the domestic reserve list played into why they dealt so many guys. They tried.
Oh no, that was kind of the over. John, that's a great question because that was the question I was going to ask. It's going to be interesting to see if going forward this becomes the norm at the deadline where teams are a lot more willing to give, because this wasn't just the Red Sox. We saw this in a lot of other deals too, where mm-hmm. it was like 2, 3, or 4 for 1s. And I do wonder if that's going to be the new norm because of where the deadline is and where the draft is. It just makes sense.
Real playoff chases.
Exactly. That this is just the new norm is, you know, you're going to see teams hesitant to deal those top guys, but they're more than happy to give up 2, 3, 4 for 1 packages and open spots up in order to get those draftees active without having to cut anyone.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it's because it's weird. It's like you look and it's like, well, this guy doesn't have great numbers, right? Or this guy, you know, he's really struggling this year. And it's like, it's one thing when you look at like, you know, I mentioned this in the last episode, the two FCL relievers who they released, like, were guys who had more walks than strikeouts in rookie ball this year, right? Like, that's the type of guy that you look and it's like, you know, probably not happening there. But like, when you're looking at a, you know, high A reliever or something, and I'm not saying this with anyone in mind, if the numbers aren't there, it doesn't mean that he's a guy that they're not working on something with, that they don't see a pitch shape or an ability to manipulate spin or anything like that, that they still like very much and want to continue working with. You know, they want to keep as many, the guys that are here because they want them to be here. So, you know, I think they would prefer not to have to cut anybody else. Might they cut one or two more guys? Yes. And just by the way, to correct something we mentioned a couple episodes ago, we had mentioned when the Red Sox drafted Alex Bouchard and Joey Gartrell, that two guys who are recovering from Tommy John surgery, draftees cannot be placed on the long-term injured list without being active on a roster for 5 days. So in other words, the player needs
to go. The owners really thought about all these loopholes.
They really did. They really did. So you can't just draft a guy knowing that he's just rehabbing and that you can throw him on the long-term IL. So I've been told that the Red Sox aren't going to do something like, you know, make them active for 5 days and just have Salem eat the roster spot. Although Salem's been playing plenty lately with, you know, one spot open or two spots open or three spots open. So I don't know how painful that would really be, but they decided against doing that because in the end you're talking one or two roster spots. So they are going to keep those guys, you know, just on the DRL and not activate them so they can deactivate them. You know, there might be a couple more releases, but I don't think it's going to be anything big. I don't think we're going to see, you know, any kind of big sort of exodus of guys like we thought might happen, because it wound up happening via trade. You know, they traded 10 guys for basically just major league pieces. That's one way to do it. So certainly seems to be part of what they were thinking, like you were saying, Ian. So let's see. Anything else? Should we go ahead and do some emails, perhaps?
Yeah, let's do emails.
Okay. Again, if you want to email us, it's podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you all want to hear about. Ian, our first email comes from, let's see, Evan sent us an email. I had him pare down his question because, you know, again, I ask y'all, you know, if you can't read the whole email in one screen on your phone, maybe, you know, make it a shade shorter. But he was basically saying, it seems like the organization has a handful of pitching prospects with average or better command and control, but a low ceiling because their stuff is fringy. Thinking of guys like Michael Sansone, Cade Feeney, Jonathan Brand, Roy Blanco, et cetera. Why not teach every pitcher in this category 6 or 7 new pitches to try out in games in the hopes that a couple of them develop new pitches that raise their ceiling? Teams probably do a version of this already, but why not be more aggressive in making wholesale changes with pitchers who have this profile? Even a low success rate seems worth it, and there's seemingly little projected value. Do you think pitchers with good command and control of their current arsenal would maintain that trait with new pitches? Would it be difficult or expensive to teach the pitches? Do you think the strategy would work? What do you think would keep teams from trying it more aggressively? Thanks for the email, Evan. Ian, I think that part of this really comes down to, it's not as easy as just like teach a guy 6 or 7 new pitches. It's when they teach guys new pitches, there are biometric traits that they have looked at that they think that pitcher will be able to successfully incorporate a pitch. They're not just saying, hey, try this knuckle curve, try the, you know,
they, yeah, you it's know. Not it's not like your high school where they just, hey, try this grip and see what it looks like. They've got, like, you know, I think they've talked about it, they have, like, you know, the high speed cameras, they then model it with like pitch optimization, like technology, kind of like showing what like spin rates and optimizing that and everything.
It's
there's
biomechanical
a lot of,
is the big,
yeah,
thing.
It's biomechanical now, exactly, thank you, that's what I was trying to say, it's just late. And I think that they're just, you know, with certain deliveries, with certain release points, with certain like ways your arm works, your a certain pitch will work better with that, and that's what they already know that, and once they get you in house they can look and kind of pair you up, basically. Mm-hmm. So it's, yeah, it's not, I don't think it's really, you know, hey, let's try 7 pitches and pick 3 that work. It's more, hey, you throw like this. This works for a bunch of guys with similar profiles. Let's try it now with you. That's, I think, more, it's more targeted would be the best way I would describe it.
Yeah, it's not as easy as like the show where you've got development points you can put towards different pitches. It's a little more nuanced than that. I mean, it's a great question. I'm not poo-pooing the question. Next email is from Patreon supporter Mike Granger. Ian? He says, what are the reports you've gotten about Justin Gonzalez? Saw that Red Sox stats posted DSL stats, and he looks like an absolute monster. Mike, first of all, you should know better than to cite a Red Sox stats tweet without thanking the good folks at Chico's Bail Bonds for the tweet. But Ian, we did get a report on some reports on Justin Gonzalez. He's an interesting guy, and that's why he snuck into the back end of the SP60.
Yeah, he's a good size, like, I'm not sure how projectable he is. He's pretty physical for the level. I think what he's listed at 6'4", 215 or something already. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But he's got juice in the bat, like good EVs, good approach, makes a lot of contact, has some power. So he's definitely an interesting guy, and someone that I think of the position players has kind of separated himself as the top prospect from that crew down there in the DSL this year.
Yep, one of the two guys they sent to the DSL All-Star game, the other one being center fielder Anderson Fermin from the other DSL squad. Yeah. Next question, Ian, comes from Forrest Perkins, another Patreon supporter, who asks, I'm wondering what we're hearing about a few of the Red Sox hard-throwing reliever prospects, Ryan Zephyr, John Luis Guerrero, Felix Zepeda, Chris Troy, Alex Hoppe. There was a lot of hype entering the year, and then I know a few ran into velocity drops or command issues early in the year. Any word on how they're progressing? Obviously, we just talked a lot about Zephyr John, but Guerrero, Cepeda, Troy, Hoppe, definitely not a group that has necessarily shown out, that has really separated themselves from the pack. I know Guerrero's been a lot better lately. I remember from looking at the numbers, but he's been kind of up and down this year. I don't know if it's command or what, but what have you seen or heard about that crew of guys so far this season?
I think that they've all been inconsistent. I think Troy most inconsistent. I haven't seen him since he got back. I'll catch him this month. He just hasn't. Portland hasn't been home a lot. It's been weird. Their schedule's been really weird lately. But Guerrero, he went on the DEV list, and I think he's been better since he came off it. And Cepeda was also spent some time on the DEV list. Hoppe has really struggled this year, so I think that
Cepeda's was really kind of perfunctory. I think that was just to get to get him a quick break.
It was just like
week. It wasn't even a week. So,
yeah, I think that all of them, like, they all have their flashes. They all have similar issues, though, in the sense that they have their flashes and they'll flash like big league quality stuff. I'm not going to count Troy in this right now, just because I don't know what his stuff looks like. Because I said the last time I saw him, he was like 88 to 90. So I don't want to make any judgments about him. But on the other three, they'll all flash, you know, mid to high 90s, one decent secondary. It's just there's just a lack of consistency. Yeah, like looking at Hoppe, he's got a walk in like 8 straight outings. He's just, you know, you can't be walking guys that much. And Cepeda tends to have similar issues. So I just think that it's just going to be about finding consistency and whether they can get their command and control to a level that gives them a chance to, you know, get at least, you know, a shot at the big leagues. Because if you're walking, like, Hoppy's got 27 walks in 38 innings. Cepeda has 16 only in 36, but even that is still way too high. So those guys are just going to really have to tighten up the command and control to have a chance.
Our next question comes from David B. This is Patreon question central, Ian. And he says he's got a Love question it. About the impact of a player's age on the impression of them as a prospect. It seems clear that being able to not only hold your own, but excel against age advanced competition is a good sign that someone may be a guy. But the question is, do you think that this gauge is more important for hitters than for pitchers? In particular, for pitchers, should the focus be more on how many years they've spent pitching, giving someone a bit older a break if they've had a lot of injuries, converted, or just fully committed to pitching late? If you have time, so that's the question. That's it. But it's a fair question. I've never really thought of it that way of, like, is age advancement more important for hitters than pitchers? I don't
think
that it is, but
I think it's kind of
get what he's
both.
Getting at to some degree. Not that I get where he's coming from.
I do too. I haven't heard. I'm actually curious now. I might ask around to see, because I know one of the biggest things age impacts is the analytical models. And you'll hear it talked about a lot that, like, certain orgs will push guys more aggressively just so that they pop in models for potential trades.
The Padres were notorious for this years ago when they did that
they
with guys like Hudson Potts.
Ethan Salas is in Double-A right now. He's an 18-year-old.
They sent DeVries to Low-A today. Yeah, I don't know if you saw that.
Raking, though.
Right.
So he might be just him. Right. But yeah, I think that I think you could make an argument for either, because the one side is, If you're a hitter holding their own against advanced pitching at a young age, that's extremely impressive. But the same could be said if you're a pitcher who's able to get more advanced hitters out, either be raw stuff or by your pitching aptitude, then that's also impressive. So I think it works. It's probably pretty equal for hitters and pitchers in terms of which is more impressive. But it's definitely for either of them, it's a very important factor.
That's about where I'm at. I mean, you always want to see guys performing at the most age advanced level that's reasonable for them. And if they're performing well, all the better. That's kind of where I'm at on it as well. Ian, our next question is from Mark, who says he pored over our and the pundits last 2 days regarding the York trade And his takeaways are, one, he agrees with the thought that this is a gamble worth taking, a controllable first starting pitcher, former first rounder, et cetera, and there's a lot of infield guys behind York. But also, two, second base has been a black hole all year. Valdez had a 684 OPS, which is shockingly not as bad as Westbrook's 584 and Grissom's 367. So his question is, if the Red Sox are really planning on Grissom sticking in AAA when he's back from his second long IL stint, and the others, see above, basically suck, why trade York? Why not instead pull him up and let him have a month to see what he can do? Well, Westbrook looks like a decent glove. He's no Gold Glover himself. And there's no way York can be as bad as Valdez is. And this is with Valdez's improvements from last year, in his opinion. Maybe they hit lightning in a bottle and York is a bit of a bottom of the order catalyst, and maybe not. But if he does, and he's still not in the future plans, the return from in the offseason would be higher. So in other words, the trade's a gamble, so is bringing York up. I wish they'd gamble on the team this year rather than next. This, of course, changes if they address second base before the deadline, which, as you talked about, maybe they did a little bit. But we talked a little bit about this, Ian, why you don't give York a shot. I mean, I think, look, if they thought... I think the reason you don't give him a shot is they probably need Priester more than they needed York.
Well, I think it's also, though, it goes back to the 40. Like, you can't add another guy to the 40 at second base. You already have Grissom taking up a spot. You already have Valdez taking up a spot. You have Westbrook on there taking up a spot now.
I mean, I think the idea would be you DFA Westbrook. Right?
I guess, but I think they're going to need to DFA Westbrook for someone else at some point. So, I'm also not sure at this point that Westbrook or York's that big an upgrade on Westbrook. Like, can you count on that? Could you guarantee that? I'm just talking about for this year, for the record.
Right.
Obviously, long term, I like York more than Westbrook, but just for this year, I don't think you can say that with certainty. And so I think York needed more time in the minors. And that's why you don't give him a shot, is just, you know, you trust that. And I think Romy Gonzalez is the name that he didn't mention. He's been hitting well, and he's someone who I think is going to get some time there also. So,
yeah, because Romy's been like platooning at first with Smith. And when Casas comes back, that frees him up to take over the Jamie Westbrook role.
Exactly.
So, I think that's where it's at. So, Ian, next question is from John B. And he says, when you guys talk about Christian Campbell's swing being strange, are you talking about the swing itself? Is it the toe tap and everything else that comes before the swing decision? Because when I saw Campbell in Portland, his swing didn't look unusual to me. It might not be a Manny Ramirez thing of beauty, but it was hardly a Julio Franco monstrosity either. Thanks for the email, John. I think it's kind of somewhere in between, Ian. I think it's something that's clearer either if you're directly behind the plate or like watching from the center field camera on MILB.com than it would be from like the stands where you're far away or something. I mean, I don't know if that's a fair way to put it, but. I think it might just be I disagree with John a little bit about it doesn't look that bad. It's part of it. But like you said, it's not like it's a monstrosity, but it's not that it's Kevin Youkilis doing all kinds of weird stuff before the pitch, but then his hands are in a position to hit and then the swing is the swing.
So no, it's not the swing itself. It's the way he gets there with his lower body largely, because a lot of guys, when you see their swing, like they have their stride, their load, and then they step with their stride and then they come through and everything's kind of synced up. Campbell is kind of like very jerky in the way that his swing works, where like his foot comes down and then his hips fire, but his lower half kind of stays there and then jumps also. And you see it a lot. I think it's more noticeable when he takes the ball actually.
Yeah.
Because it's very aggressive take, where there's just like his whole body is moving during his take. It's never when you watch Tristan Costin, he just stares at a pitch. He just won't even move really, because he knows it's a ball the entire time. Campbell is more like he gets after it and he looks like he's going to swing at every pitch until the very last second when he decides not to. And so that's kind of the part that's kind of funky with it. It's just, there's just so much going on and so much loud movement. In all aspects of it. It's not just in like the load and the way he does stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fair. It's you got to kind of see it from the right angle, I think, is part of it. Trying to think, Ian, I was debating whether or not to read this one, but we had a Mark emailed us asking about Eli Marrero, I'm not going to read the email because he's basically saying that, you know, I don't agree with his take on Eli Marrero as a player, but I want to encourage emails where folks ask us about specific players they're curious about. Eli Marrero, at this point, he calls a good game. He's got a good arm. He's solid behind the plate. Just really can't hit. Type of high minors organizational player that every organization needs. He's going to play in the high minors as long as he probably wants to. He's an interesting player that way, but like, you can just see when you got a player who it gets used, like the Red Sox used him this year, where like he was in AAA, and when it was time to move guys up to AAA, they moved him down to AA. You know, it's a high minors, important to the organization, org catcher type profile on Marrero. Is that fair?
Yeah, agree. Yeah.
So, yeah, but I mean, he's an interesting guy. He can also run a little bit for a catcher, which is interesting. But, you know, he's a very important organizational player, is I guess what I would say on that. And then actually, Ian, the last question, this is kind of a tough one, and maybe we'll just give the short answer. Our friend Matt Corey asked a question that was intended for the podcast last week with Jim. Sorry, I just ran out of time to ask all the questions we had for him, Matt. Matt was asking, a year in, how are you liking the 2023 draft class? Are you higher or lower on it than you were at this time last year? Is there anyone who has exceeded your expectations, which... loaded question. Obviously, Christian Campbell has exceeded our expectations.
Yeah,
but it's looking, it's interesting, Ian, because if you go down the list, Kyle Teal has performed about as well as you could have reasonably hoped.
Yep.
Campbell has performed far better than you could have reasonably hoped.
Mm-hmm.
Connelly Early's been good. Yep. He's been very good. Got the double A. I'm trying to do the positives and then go back. The rest, you know, Max Carlston and Nelly Taylor for day two guy. Blake Wehunt, I missed in the ninth round, has been very good. There's a lot of really good guys here. But JoJo Grassi has been solid in Salem. And some interesting, you know, reliever types here, like Max Carlson in the 12th round is kind of interesting. Nelly Taylor is an above slot 11th rounder.
Matt Duffy's been
fine. Matt Duffy's been fine in the 4th round.
Yeah.
Reamer, well, by the way, I confirmed it's Justin Reamer.
It's too early to say.
Basically, but you know, they're clearly high on
the problem is the second and third round.
Yeah, the problem is Nizan Zanatello and Antonio Anderson. Anderson has actually been better lately. He's starting to maybe come around, perhaps. Zanatello, the K rate's in the 40s. I mean,
yeah,
that's tough.
That was the concern coming in, was he's a guy who needed work with the approach, and with the way that they're working on it, there's such an emphasis on bat speed. That's not necessarily what he probably needed. So the raw tools are still there. It's just, he's got to learn how to hit, frankly, is the best way to put it.
I talked to someone recently who saw him a bunch in high school and said, I loved this kid in high school, and I watched his at bats this year, and the explosiveness is gone. I don't get what happened, which is weird because the explosiveness being gone is not something you would think with the way the Red Sox put an emphasis on bat speed and that kind of thing, right? Like,
yeah.
So it's like, are the hamstring issues still bothering him? Like, who knows?
It's hard for me to say because I haven't seen him yet. I'll hopefully see him by the end of the season. But
I'm hopefully going to see him. And they come to Fredericksburg in August, so I'm going to make sure I get down there.
It's definitely a concern. We're approaching the concerning threshold for me.
Yeah, it's at the point now where, you know, look, when you believe in a guy, you keep him at a spot, even though the back of the baseball card numbers don't look great, right? But, like, you can only run a 40% strikeout rate for so long before I'm just kind of like, you know, what's happening here?
Yeah, because Zanatello is tough, too, because we didn't see him in spring training. He was just hurt the entire time either.
Right. And we didn't did we see much of Antonio? I guess we saw Antonio Anderson.
Yeah, we saw Anderson, and I was slightly concerned with what I saw in spring training. Just there was a lot of swing and miss, and he just wasn't really driving the ball. And that's kind of carried over to the season. And I know you said he's been better lately, but even in that stretch, isn't it mostly singles?
It might be. Yeah. I don't think it's a ton of power. I'm going to try and bring it up real quick, but it's probably not.
Yeah, since 6'8", he's in 34 games, he's 282, 361, 428. So that's not terrible, actually. 12 extra base hits. It's not terrible, actually. 38 strikeouts is way too many, though. in, you know, 131 plate appearances, so it's almost above a 30% K rate.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that the thing that's weird with Anderson is the power was kind of seen as one of the selling points with him. He's just not hitting for the type of power that it was kind of advertised coming out of the draft. And when he's a corner guy now, I think, is he playing any shortstop?
He's playing a decent amount of shortstop, actually. Arias there, he's not. He was basically playing shortstop, swapping in with Zanatello for a while, but now with Arias there, Arias is getting those shortstop starts.
But he's a third baseman now. Most likely he's going to have to hit for more power, and it's just not, he hasn't shown that yet.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah. You can't write either of them off, but it's just obviously you would have loved to see them start stronger. But I mean, I would say it's about what you expect. Like, there are a couple hits. The first round pick is doing great. After that, you know, you got a couple hits, you got a couple TBDs, and we'll evaluate again in a year.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And you know, we one of the great questions we got with Jim last week, Ian, was someone asked what does a successful draft look like, which we've asked him before, but I think it's worth answering every year because he makes the point, like, he does the redrafts every year, and like, you know, 10 years out from a draft, the average regulars end at like pick 20. Like, this is not something where you expect the team to get three average full-time regulars from a draft in a given year. So, you know, it's tough. And so if Teal's the only thing the Red Sox get out of the draft last year, you smile and say thank you, you know, to the fates for giving that, you know, giving you that outcome. So anything else from that is gravy, especially when you've got Christian Campbell coming out of it too. So, all right, Ian, shall we go ahead and wrap it up then? I think that's everything. We haven't missed anything, right? All right. Well, we'll go ahead and wrap it up then. Thank you all for listening to the show. Shout out to our podcast producer, Daniel Fox. You can follow the site on social media at Sox Prospects. Follow Ian at Ian Cundall. That's IANCUNDALL. Follow me at SP Chris Hatfield. We want to thank the Ludlow Thieves for our intro and outro music. All the money, find their music wherever you listen to your tunes. And thank you to all of our supporters on patreon.com/SoxProspects and who have supported the Sox Prospects donation drive. You've got like a day left. Get in there before the first. Actually, it's past midnight. So yeah, you've got less than a day now. Again, if you want to support us at patreon.com/SoxProspects, you can pledge a certain amount per episode and get some neat perks, which can include getting your name read on the show. And this week, we want to thank Chris Beaulieu, Curtis Waltman, Michael Stewart, Caleb Farron, Jason Stoneburner, Grayson Sinner, Stephen G. Shaw, Jason Parker, Mike Granger, and Jeff Richardson. Thank you all for your support, and thank you to all of our Patreon and other supporters out there in the world. We'll be back soon with more of the web's best coverage on the Red Sox organization, so keep your ears to the feed. Hope you all enjoyed the trade deadline. Let's calm down and watch some baseball. Thanks, everybody.